You're almost there, buddy. You good? Solid. We are back here for another one, the MoneyPot podcast, with your homie, Moss Money, and of course my right-hand man, my co-host, Steve-O, Headbanger. Yep. So we're going to get right into it, man, because this Colin Kaepernick stuff I can't even say it's Colin Kaepernick, it's just the world, you know, as a whole right now, is just really crazy right now. So I'm going to speak on it real quick, Steve, and then I know you got tons of stuff to say on it real quick. So let me get my little two-piece out, and then you go ahead and, you know, go off.
Take your time, man. Do what you need to do.
So right now, I mean, the world is just crazy. And I think what Cap, it's hard to say that he started it, but he opened the conversation up, you know, in a very profound and smart way on his platform, and it's very revolutionized-esque, if you want to say. Let me ask you this question, Steve. In an essence, is he becoming what Muhammad Ali was in his day when he spoke up? Does he symbolize what Rosa Parks was when in her situation that we all know? I mean,
it's that strong. It's that it makes that much of a statement. What he's doing is making a statement,
right?
And going against what a regular American person would do,
right?
Just stand up and put their hand across their chest to salute the flag. So I would say yes.
Okay, so it's an interesting time then that we're in, that we're seeing is right in front of us. You know, it's really history. You know, you always think about. In those times, I remember asking my mom in those times, you know, when Martin Luther King was alive and how she felt and, you know, what was her thought process. And it's kind of funny that we're living in those times now. But the funny thing is that my mom, you know, she was a bystander, and I don't want to be a bystander. I want to be a part of the conversation. I don't want to sit back. I don't want to not say anything. I will raise my hand. Matter of fact, I will raise my fist in unity with my brothers and sisters, with my family and my kids that are mixed, by the way. And I will teach my children how to understand their ancestry past and their present, because right now we are living in history. And then, you know, in saying that, I feel Killer Mike had a video that was on Facebook, mm-hmm. and he spoke a lot of truth in that forum that he was sitting. How can, as parents, how can our in this generation talk about all the injustice in the world but not be a part of it? Not, you know, in all these protests that are going in from Tulsa to Charlotte, where are the schools? Where are the, you know, some of our higher, quote-unquote, ranking, you know, black affiliates like doctors, principals, senators, congressmen? Where are all these individuals when, you know, we need leadership the most? And
a lot of them fear for their status.
Right.
You know, brought down by what they're saying. I mean, a lot of them see what's going on and want to be a part of it, but don't want to jeopardize their livelihood and how they feed their families. So I can't understand it because...
I don't understand it at all.
I wouldn't take that stance on it, because if I felt right. that something needed to be, you know, fixed and I can be the one that helped the cause, then I'm going to try to do it. But, I mean, everyone has a different thought process. And when you speak of the Killer Mike video, T.I. just brought a video.
Yeah, I didn't see it.
It's called Warzone. If you guys get a chance to, you know, 5 minutes, go check it out on YouTube. It's just, in this video, he shows how things could be if it was the reverse way. So, in this video, he shows the Philando killing. Okay. But instead of it being him, it's a white man in a car with, you know, a white girlfriend and a white kid.
Is that the one?
And it was a black cop that was doing it.
Is that the one where, what did he say? He said he had a gun on him and he still got shot? Is that incident? Okay.
Yeah, so he shows different scenarios that just happened with a lot of the killings as of recent, and it's in that video, but it's reversed as it was black cops doing it towards white citizens. So if you guys get a chance to check that out, I think that was a good message in his actual lyrics as well as the video itself.
Right. So, and going along with what I was saying before about being a role model and teaching my children, you know, our ancestry past, you know, I just feel, what kind of role model am I if I don't do that? You know, how is my son going to look at me back in these days if I just keep going to work, saying yes, sir, no, sir, paying my bills, just going on in a monotonous and kind of arrogance way about, oh, everything will be fine. You know, if you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem, as they say. Mm-hmm. So, our youth is our future. You know, there's a change going on in the world, and we need to plant the seeds to help nurture them and their growth. But in that same conversation, we are the future as well. And, you know, the baby boomers are retiring. You know, debt is at an all-time high.
Right.
There's technological advances as of right now that, you know, we saw when we were growing up and kids. I mean, like the Jetsons, you know, Back to the Future, all that stuff is coming a reality. And I think that's, you know, that's, we have to take that into account when we look ahead. We have to understand the times and the changes. And we also have to understand the times and the changes in our social environment, and our, how can I say, our racial environment, per se. And we have to...
I don't necessarily think that it's a change in the way we're viewed and the way that, you know, right, African Americans are treated. It's just more cameras, and it's more people that has
that is true. That is true.
You know, cameras nowadays at your fingertips with your telephone. So
exactly.
It's more exposed because of that, and a lot of people are just pulling out their cameras now because they're not sure what's going to happen, and they want to make sure that they're being treated like a citizen, which still isn't being done. And now, you know, as Americans, we're being exposed to it because it's on the news
every day.
Every day is
just crazy.
And it's being shown from what, helicopter views, from body camera views, dashboard views, the views of civilians.
Right.
So we're getting it from different angles, and it's kind of, you know, depressing just to watch the news nowadays.
I don't watch it, yo. Like I don't watch the news, and when there is a video from either, you know, somebody posted, you know, World Star, or, you know, wherever your media outlet is of where you get information, I don't even watch it. I'm tired of seeing us being executed live on TV. I'm just tired of watching it. I'm about being part of the solution, like I said earlier. I want to be a part of something that is not only peaceful, but, you know, smart in how we attack it. And I think Michael Bennett came out and said that we might need a Caucasian individual to kind of lead that charge and lead that conversation. And, you know, to a degree, he's completely right, because we don't have a lot of black judges. We don't have a lot of black congressmen. We don't have a lot of black just government in general that can understand and, how can I say, understand and connect with what most black folks, you know, African-American males are going through at this time period. And that's vital into delivering that message, because if you are fortunate enough to be an African-American male who grew up in the suburbs, who grew up with a silver spoon in your mouth, who grew up, you know, on quote unquote, you know, the better side of the street, then you're not going to understand people who go through that everyday struggle, who go through with that mindset that, you know, I need to have.
Go ahead. I'm not sure if that's completely correct, because
right.
In the view of a police officer, they don't know how you grew up. They don't know what.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
So I'm sure some of them may have encountered the same kind of treatment that someone from the inner city may encounter.
Now you're absolutely right.
They might not necessarily have went through some of the same struggles, but I mean, just because some people live in the suburbs and they're black, they're still treated differently.
No, you're absolutely right.
So it may not be to the extent of an inner city kid, but to say that they don't know, I have to disagree with you on that, because a police officer is going to treat someone from Philadelphia and somebody from Cheltenham the same way, or Glenside or Willow Grove.
Right.
If they're black, they see one color. And like I said, not
that's
all
real,
police.
That's real.
It's not all police. So I don't want everybody thinking that we're saying all police target black people, but it's a large...
It's a majority.
...amount of them that do.
No, you're absolutely right, because I'll be the first one to tell you, even though a lot of my friends are quote-unquote hood guys or street guys, I am not. You know, I grew up in West Philadelphia, around right down the street from West Philly High School, 48th and Hazel. But my mom got me out of that environment when I was young. I think we moved out around like when I was like 11 years old. Mm-hmm. And I've been in Mount Airy, you know, Germantown area for the rest of my life. And that's West Side Mount Airy, you know, which is a nicer side of the Mount Airy area. So, and I went to private school. When I graduated in eighth grade, it was only about four or five black kids.
Right.
So, you know, you're absolutely right in that statement where, you know, we are judged by pretty much, you know, judge a book by its cover,
right,
instead of knowing what the actual background is. Mm-hmm. And you're absolutely right on that one.
And just to touch on that, I just saw a video of two Philadelphia police officers,
uh-huh,
that, you know, approached a group of black kids on a corner and was asking them to give up information on a suspect for something. They didn't really go into detail as to what they were looking for,
right?
But the kids didn't want to say anything, so they asked them to, you know, disperse from the corner.
Okay.
And the one kid, he responded, he said, "Come on guys, let's hurry up because they're going to shoot one of us." And the response of the police officers was, "Not all of you, just one." Like, are you serious? And this is on camera. And they blurred out the faces of the police officers.
Of course they did.
Because they said, oh, we're not sure that it came from one of them. Uh-huh. But it came from one of them. He said, "Not all of you, just one." Like, are you kidding me?
Yeah, that's crazy, bro. And I actually wrote a couple of things that I know are current right now. So we have, I think is it from Tulsa? Terrence Crutcher? Is that Tulsa?
Terrence Crutcher is from Tulsa, and Keith Scott is from Charlotte.
Yeah, so that's a Charlotte. And then there was, I saw you put on Facebook, the Facebook on the cops that planted a gun on a suspect. And I wasn't sure who that was.
And that was Keith Scott in Charlotte. That was the Charlotte murder, yeah.
Yeah, that was crazy.
So as you look at the video.
Right.
And at first, you want to believe that it was, you know, edited. Somebody did some type of editing to it. But at the same time, you can look, and it's not, because you go on CNN actual website to look it up, and you'll see the exact same thing. Now, some right. people are trying to argue that it was a glove dropped by an officer that wasn't the actual gun, and I'm not quite sure.
Because why would they drop anything anyway, though? That's the point.
Right, because now that's messing with the crime scene.
Exactly.
So, and then you go back and you see the officer pick up whatever it was on the ground.
Right.
So I'm not sure what's going on there, but there's some, you know, questions that's going to arise from it.
Right. And another thing, too, going along with that one, I saw the Facebook one that you put up, and then the Bears game, when they were singing the national anthem, they had, like, the Nazi salute going on. Yeah, now, yeah. I didn't take it as that until you said something. It's funny. I thought about it when you said something. I was like, nah, that can't really be this serious. So, but I don't know, you know, perception is to the individual. So
I'm going to ask you this.
Right.
When you raise your fist in the air, what is that perception?
Exactly. I know exactly. No, Black
absolutely.
Unity.
Absolutely.
Right.
Now, when they did that stance, what is that perception?
Hold on.
We got a call coming in.
We got a call coming in.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
So, I mean, my take on it was, you know, I had to point it out because it's like, are you serious?
It's funny. I saw it and I thought about it, but you know how what I said before is just like, our own ignorance of just letting it kind of just go over our heads.
Right, because you don't want to believe
exactly
that's what it is.
But I'm thinking football there. I'm thinking Eagles there. I'm not thinking about Nazi signs. But I did, I promise you on everything, I acknowledged it in my own head, but I just kind of just like looked past it. I was just like, you know what? Like, it's a football game.
The thing about
but
it
the
is,
whole crowd was doing it. Like, it was crazy.
The media looked past it as well.
Right.
Because they don't want to put anything out on that. They'll rather focus and zero in on Malcolm Jenkins and Ryan Brooks and Stephen Means
right,
putting
yeah.
up their fists.
Yeah, I definitely took a picture of that too, and I hope Malcolm Jenkins gets that framed because it was a powerful image to me.
Right.
It represents our Philadelphia Eagles. I was surprised that of the two individuals standing next to him, I was surprised that it wasn't more of some of the higher-end kind of leadership guys right. on the team mm-hmm. because there was a lot of talks about the whole team doing something, even Doug Peterson doing that. And then when push comes to shove, you see really who has the gall to do it. And
yeah,
it was only three of them.
Yeah.
Right. And I was kind of surprised by that.
Yeah, but I mean, I just thought it was really good. It was a good stance for them. Like we always say, that you use your platform to, you know, voice your opinion.
Exactly. And
he got a lot of backlash from it.
So, did he really?
Yeah.
I didn't read anything on that.
So it was one person that went on Twitter and said, I wish Malcolm Jenkins will be paralyzed in this game.
This is
after
crazy.
Doing that.
This is crazy.
Then you had the one kid. He was eventually suspended from his university.
I think I saw something about that, but I didn't read too much into it. And while you look up, you know, some of that info, I want to just give a shout out to a couple of people I see that logged on online on Facebook. I want to make sure that, you know, I stay in tune with our audience on Facebook. I saw Mick join, my man Brandon from LA Fitness. I see you, David Kinneman from back in the day from grade school. We go back to third grade, buddy. Thanks for coming on and kind of support me and listening. My big homie, Tim Richardson, I want to give a shout out to him and his beautiful wife, Alicia. They're about to expecting a new baby. I'm hoping it's a boy. You know what I mean? We know our men love our boy. Shout out to my sister-in-law, Lulu, and my aunt-in-law, Renee, for joining. And actually, no, I can't forget you, Johnny McVay. We all know who McVay is. Back in the day from LaSalle, man, stand up. I did say Richardson, man. Get out of here with all that, Timmy.
Well, yeah. Now, with the guy posted on Malcolm Jenkins.
Right.
It says, piece of shit, N-word. Every one of them needs a damn bullet in their head.
That's crazy. I think
if
I did see this.
If you do not like this country, get the hell out.
No coverage about that at all. You had to dig deep for that one, probably.
Yeah. I mean, I saw it on the news. They did, you know, the university that he attended did expel him. He's expelled, but being expelled, what is that going to do? He's still going to have the same feelings that he has now, and yeah. all he's going to do is enroll into another college.
No, that's real.
And get the education. And Mike Ditka is almost in the same boat, because he's like, if they don't like the country, they don't like the flag, get the hell out.
That's a Mike Ditka statement, too.
Yeah, but are we going to let him ride because it's a Mike Ditka statement? He also said, I do not see all the atrocities going on in this country.
Right.
That people say are going on.
Right.
I'm guessing he's blind. I just want to believe that he's blind. Because if you're not seeing what's going on, then he's part of the problem, big time.
No, he is part of the problem. And we talked about this before we went on. And I was trying to at least understand the fact that he's from an older generation. His grandfather more likely has slaves, but that's no excuse.
No excuse.
At all. We live in today's world, not 40, 50 years ago. So, Mike Dicker, if you ever hear me, if this airway ever plays to you, man, tighten up, dickhead.
Eat it.
Wow. That was live, so we might have to go back and edit that.
Yeah.
No. A little bleep.
I apologize, but hey, that's just how we came out of that moment.
Yeah, that's how Steve O was feeling. So we're gonna let him slide on that one.
But I honestly don't understand how you say you don't see what's going on in the country. It's on the news every single day.
Right.
Every single day.
Right.
And like I said before, because some people aren't affected by it, then they don't care about it.
Right. Now, yeah.
They don't care because it's not pretty much affecting Mike Dicker. He's living his life the way he want to live his life.
He's living his life wild, too, by the way.
Absolutely. He's a Hall of Fame coach. So,
uh-huh.
I mean, he got a lot to do with himself.
Did you see the picture of Kaepernick? He actually went to an Oakland high school.
Yeah, and they were, like, laying on the ground.
Yeah, I don't know.
Is that really Cap?
I look like Cap. I mean, the afro and everything was out there. I didn't see it close up.
So
I didn't see it close up either, but it said it was him, though.
Yeah, and the other, all the kids were laying on the ground with their hands up.
Yeah, see, I would have rather them all kneel with Cap than doing that. I mean, it's hard to say that. It's a drastic measure when you look every day and you see on TV and guys are on the ground being tased and then shot
right.
point blank. And then speaking of that officer with the Terrence Crutcher.
The lady.
Yeah, the lady. You know, she's not getting charged for murder. Manslaughter.
Yeah. Which is going
to. What, 2 to 4 years?
About 2 to 4 years.
And paid leave, by the way.
Yeah. Which is vacation.
This is atrocity.
Yeah, it's horrible, man.
It's terrible.
It's a bad situation. But, I mean, as a black man myself, I have no idea what to do when I'm pulled over now.
Yeah, it's scary.
Like, you can't even put your arms out the window. You don't know if you want to put your hands on the ceiling, keep them on the wheel. And Malcolm Jenkins said that what made him realize the seriousness of what's going on is that that the security come in and talk to the NFL players at the beginning of the season about just everything, how to stay safe, how to keep your family safe,
right?
Your homes and everything. Now, he said that they talk to the players on how to survive a police encounter. How to survive a police encounter. He said, I'm here to coach you on how to survive the encounter.
Wow.
What exactly? Why do you need to teach someone on how to survive a police encounter?
They need training, man. They need training bad. Like, I think Kaepernick said that before in one of his press conferences, that I think he said something like a hairdresser or I forget who else did he mention or who else did he compare it to. But, like, a hairdresser has, like, what, like 9 months of training, but a cop, you can be a cop with a handgun License to kill in, like, what, 4 or 5 months or something like that?
They go through extensive training. I think it's about 6 months.
Is it six months? Is that enough time, you think? Is that enough? Do we need to relook at the training process?
You got to think about it. Now, do they need to go back to train after a certain amount of years on the force?
Right.
So, a lot of times it'd be guys that may be veterans that's in 10 years at times.
Right, right.
So do they need to revisit, you know, training? And I'm not sure if they do training. Some of them may do just like a rebuffer course on how you know, go about different situations.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, as much training as you go through, that's not going to stop someone's thinking in a split decision.
Right.
And if they really want to do it, they're going to do it because they're back. And it's hard because a lot of the police, they try to promote people to come in and, you know, give a statement on something or to snitch. They want to stop the no snitching clause. But how can you tell someone to give up information if y'all not doing the same thing on y'all end? Y'all see what's going on.
Right.
Y'all know the cops in y'all department that are bad cops.
Right,
and,
right,
and
right.
Y'all not going on record to tell on them. So how can you ask everyday citizens to, okay, well, I need you to give me information on Steve because he's a suspect in this crime. But you're not going to give up your counterpart. Like, it doesn't work like that. And that's why it's going to always be some type of, you know, restraint on people not giving them information. Like, people keep their mouths shut because you got to practice what you preach. You can't tell me to do it, and you're not going to do it.
Absolutely. So, like I said before, I'm going to be part of the solution. So, I'm constantly trying to think of different ways to help as best I can. I think we're in a really kind of scary time, especially with the election going on, Trump and Hillary. Who knows how that's going to sway? I honestly think Trump is going to win, to be honest with you. I'm not voting this year. I'm just not. For what? For who? Who am I voting for?
I mean, it's that's your opinion. I can't tell you to vote or not, but I was always told since I, like, by one of my teachers, Mr. Leonard.
Okay.
He always told us, he would never tell us who he voted for.
Right.
But he would always say, if you don't vote, then you have no reason to complain. You can't complain if you don't vote.
Right.
So, I mean, I've always voted since I was able to vote. I'm not sure I'm going to vote for her, but I'm going to have to vote. I don't know how. But.
So here's a funny thing. I had a conversation with a good friend of mine, and I forget what we were talking about, what is not being covered right now. It was something. I'll remember it. But we were talking about Barack Obama, and we were so happy to have a black president. But if we look at his 8 years, can we say he's done a lot for black people?
Well, the first 4 years, he had to clean up somebody else's mess.
Okay.
So he was in office trying to clean up what George Bush did.
Right.
And it's funny because I had this conversation earlier.
Okay.
About, you know, Barack Obama and Bill Clinton and, you know, just the presidents that we had. That we've had that was supposed to be in favor of the middle to lower class. And,
right.
I mean, Barack Obama, you got to look at it. He hasn't done a whole lot for, you know, black people, but you also got to look at the House. It's ran by Republicans.
Okay.
So when, you know, he's ready to push stuff through, if they don't push it through, that's their Republicans. So it's like, yeah, we got some of what we wanted, but not all of what we need.
No, you can. I agree. And it was just a funny conversation because you would think that, you know, Barack would show some lenience or some way on how to get, you know, more elected
black. So what would you have liked for Barack Obama to do more of?
Was I don't, we had a conversation about it, and my friend was bringing up points. I haven't really, like, dived into it. I'm not really a big into politics.
Right.
I know I should be starting to at least pay attention, and I try my best to. I know that he has done a lot for the debt. I know he has done, like, Obamacare is kind of who you're talking to, if they like it or not. But I heard, a friend told me as well that even if you don't get Obamacare, you still get taxed at the end of the year.
Okay.
Or something to that degree. I would have to, you know, kind of research a little bit more to speak on it more intelligently.
And I've seen that some of the things he did as recently.
Did we get any tax breaks? I don't even know. Did we get any type of tax breaks or anything? I don't think so
either. But he, you know, freed some of the criminals that was arrested for nonviolent crimes. Like,
right.
That was getting like 20, 30 years for selling drugs or, you know, getting caught with illegal substances. And people that's
right.
Killing people are getting 5 to 7 years. Or let's look at the woman and the Tulsa cop. She murdered that man on camera and she's getting manslaughter.
It's crazy. It's funny you said that because I remember what I wanted to say earlier. How about this? They show people getting murdered on TV. On any type of social media feed, you can repost it, you can share it.
Right.
But you say some type of gay slogan, slur, you get cut, you get reported. How crazy is that? Just think about that, and that's dynamic, y'all. We are watching people being executed live on TV. But when we say faggot, gay, homo, and you're reported, I mean, you might lose your Facebook account. You might lose your Twitter account or Instagram. Like,
yeah,
that's a systematic thing. Like, that's not, like, how can I say, that's not, like, somebody picking and choosing, you know, who gets it and who doesn't. That's in the system. That's the core. And when you think about that, how many people have we seen die live on television? And that's African-American folks. You know, our white Caucasian counterparts, you know, we see them blowing up things, priests who get off. Just like the cop you were just mentioning who off.
You don't see them being executed on television. Just like the bomber that was in New York and New Jersey.
He walked away from away.
He had a flesh wound.
Yes.
He had a shootout with the police and he had a flesh wound. Now I know they try to say that, oh well, we don't like to kill the quote unquote terrorists because they want to get to the bottom of it and get
But we can kill our own.
And get more information out of it, but we're just going to kill this guy because...
And it's five of us.
He looked like he was about to open up his car door to do... For what?
Oh, what did the helicopter... I'm not sure if it was the helicopter or the cop.
It was the helicopter guy.
He looks like a bad man.
He looks like a bad dude.
From the helicopter. His hands up.
He looks like he's on something.
But his hands were up and he looks like a bad dude. I'm a bad man, man.
You got to be kidding me.
The world we live in, y'all, I'm telling you, the world we live in, it's a crazy place. So, you know, be safe, support each other, let us unify, whether we're black, white, we understand what real justice is, we understand what right from wrong is. Let's not be scared of the system, and I will try my best to continue on this conversation. I will try my best to be a part of the solution, and you know, whatever that takes, whatever that I gotta do, I will try my best to be the best role model for, you know, my kids as I can be, because like I said before, my kids are mixed, but when we go out into the world, my kids will be looked at as black kids,
right?
So I think we could keep going if we want, but I think it's time for football, buddy.
Yeah. Let's lighten up the conversation.
Yeah, let's lighten up the conversation. Let's get into football. So we had a lot of injuries, man. I even tried to write them down. We got Danny Woodhead out. AP's out. Jamal Charles still hasn't played. Arian Foster ain't nothing new. Stewart from the Carolina Panthers ain't nothing new. Doug Martin, Thomas Ross, Sammy Watkins. And actually, while we were talking, I saw, what's his name? From the Packers. Oh, what's his name?
I don't know.
The outside linebacker. Clay Matthews. Yeah, he's not playing this week. Corey Coleman got hurt. Josh McClown from the Browns. Cutler, Moncrief.
Even the backup quarterback from
who?
The third string from the Patriots got
hurt. Yeah. He hurt his thumb.
Yeah.
He tore ligaments in his thumb. Is he out?
I'm going to assume so.
Wow.
But
Belichick still gets a win. Belichick could go out there and they'll still get a win. He'll figure it out. Mr. Ertz, Gates is out. So it's just a slew of injuries really early, too, to a lot of, big players. I forgot. You know, I just thought about when I'm looking at Danny Woodhead. We already talked about, but Keenan Allen is out as well. So, and there's a lot of people hurting. I think Julio's banged up. There's a lot of banged up players as well. It's because they're getting off them steroids and them supplements, man.
I don't know that, man. I mean,
I'm just talking that talk.
It's a violent game, man. You know, you're going to be hurt for the whole 17 weeks, man.
Right.
Including your bye week. So,
uh-huh.
And, you know, you're going into the playoffs. They're hurt all the way up into the Super Bowl, man. So, it's just the nature of the game. It's a violent sport. It's just pain management is key. Whatever they give you. A lot of those guys are able to, you know, pop a few pills and they're good to go out there to maintain and play through the pain. But
I wish I had the sound bite for Papa Molly right now. That would have been right on key. I would have been right on key. I got to get that one. So let us go to the Eagles right now. So let's talk about the good, the bad, and, you know, a little bit of playoffs.
I'm not sure about that right now.
Yeah, we'll talk about it when we get there. So, what do you think about the good right now? I mean, I wrote a couple of things down. I think Wentz and Dougie P look like a great match at the moment right now.
Right.
And the play calling, I think, is really smart. You know, Wentz's execution of the play calling is even better. He's got a command of the huddle, his communication, how he breaks down the X's and O's in real time as well. And the key thing for me as a rookie quarterback, no turnovers. No turnovers at all.
And that's the thing about these rookies right now, rookie quarterbacks that start. And hey, man, Dak Prescott, no turnovers. As much as I don't want to admit it, but I mean, I think the good with the Eagles, I mean, starting with the defense, overall they're fourth in yards allowed, giving up 286 yards a game total, which is pretty good. 10th versus the run, they're giving up 92 yards a game, which is, you know, it's not over 100, so I'll take that.
And it's funny you said that before. I didn't mean to cut you off there, but as you're talking about, everybody keeps saying about the Browns and the Bears, and I understand how bad those teams are.
They stink.
And they do stink, man, but it's still a win in a National Football League.
You take what you get. I mean, you can't.
Yeah, it's not like it's his fault that.
We pick to play those.
Exactly. So, exactly.
I mean, if they're in front of you, you play the one, because they're going to come out and play the one as well.
Exactly.
So, I mean, and, you know, the Eagles' defense is second overall in points allowed, giving up 12.6 points a game, so.
And Brandon Graham showing up big time.
Yeah, he is. I mean, you got to give credit when credit due. A lot of it comes off of the fact that Fletcher Cox is getting doubled and triple teamed, so it's forcing somebody else to make a play, and he's been able to beat that one.
Yeah, but is that anything new? Like, he got double teamed and triple teamed last year.
Yeah, it is. It is new because I've seen last game, man, they had three guys on him.
They don't move him around as much as they did last year. I think that's another thing, too. They got him in one spot.
Right.
Because last year, we were 3-4 last year, right? Yeah. So they moved
him. He played the end in the 3-4.
Yeah, he played the end, but then he would move the nose. Like, they would shuffle him around a little bit.
Right.
For matchup, purposes. So, and then Graham is, it's crazy to say it, but he's the highest-rated DN in the league right now.
Yeah, he's beating the man in front of him, and that's all you can ask him to do. It don't matter who's in front of him. He beats whoever there is in front of him.
Right. So what do you got for the bad? I'm talking,
The bad. The drops. The drops from these receivers.
I didn't put that, but that's a great hit right there.
I mean, we didn't see two touchdowns dropped just last game.
Yeah, I didn't see the Aguilar one. I saw the Matthews one. Yeah, How bad was the Aguilar one?
It was bad. He had it in his hands, and all he had to do was bring it down. Granted, that the defender was able to stick his hand in there, but he had enough time to grab it and tuck it or, you know, just okay. secure it.
I did sell that one. I thought it was another one that I missed, but I thought Matthews was worse because Wentz put it right on the money.
It was right in the bread basket. So it was right there.
It dropped right there for him. But he's due one or two of those a game. He always has.
But that's not an excuse. That's not okay for us to say that.
It's not.
He's due one or two of those a game.
Right.
He got three drops in two games.
Are two of them touchdowns or just that one was the touchdown? Was the other one a touchdown he dropped?
I don't care if it's a touchdown or not.
It's a drop.
You dropped the ball. You got to catch that ball.
I hear you. And we do have a big test, and we'll get to that in the games.
Hold on. Another bad I got is Lane Johnson suspension.
Yeah, that's coming.
After the bye, I think they suspect him to be suspended, which the bye gives them, you know, a little bit of time just to switch over, you know, switch the piees around, get them a little comfortable.
They said Barber, right? Just going to right tackle.
Yeah, and I think they're going to slide the rookie in.
Left guard.
At left guard.
Yeah.
But with Lane Johnson gone,
it's going to hurt.
Yeah, because Carson Wentz is already taking too many hits. He needs to learn how to, you know.
Part of him is that his fault, though.
Yeah, run out of bounds, slide, do whatever he needs to do to preserve himself, because in this league, you keep taking hits like that, something is bound to happen. He's going to be injured for a week or two or whatever.
I remember the one player was running out of bounds against Chicago, and I'm not. Excuse me if I murder his name, but Danny
Trevathan. Yeah, he smacked him.
Yeah. And it was just like, there's no reason for you to get hit like that, B. Like, there's nothing to take that hit. For what? So, now I completely agree. You hit a lot of good points. I actually went just on the defense. I think, as I said before, you know, when we talk about the games, the Steelers are going to be a huge test. You know, I'm still not sold on our secondary. We're going to see what they do against good, you know, players and good opposition. You know, our D-line has to get pressure. And, you know, as of right now, Graham is the only one who's getting constant pressure. That's what the Y-9 is built for.
Now, I wouldn't say he's the only one getting pressure. He's the only one that's getting home to the most point.
Who's getting pressure?
But I've seen Connor Barwin. I've seen...
That was just the one game.
This is only two games in. So, I mean, it's been pressure up the middle. A lot of the quarterbacks have learned to get rid of the ball a lot quicker.
We talking about like Benny Logan?
Yeah, some of them has been, you know, creating pressure. It's just that Brandon Graham is really getting home and he's standing out. But the wide nine is really...
It's about the DNs getting a field, though, I thought.
Right.
And, I mean, everybody gets sacks. A field. But yeah.
So that they're not reaching their goal right now you know, getting home and getting a sack. But, I mean, they have altered some of the throws and everything, but...
And I think we need more turnovers. We are +4 right now in the turnover category, but right. I just... For us to be successful on defense, we just don't have enough players. I'm going to say that. Enough talent on defense, you know, to be, you know, kind of like successful in that category.
I don't know about that. But
yeah.
I mean,
you love some Jenkins there, buddy.
Yeah, man. You're not going to tell me they don't have enough talent on the defensive side, because they have a ton of talent.
Who? Outside of Cox, who is a talent? I mean, and I give you Graham. Graham is a good player.
Okay. So, there you go, Graham.
And Cox. Who else?
You said outside of them, Malcolm Jenkins. What are you talking about?
All right, man. We're going to keep it moving.
No, it's no. Let's back up.
What has Malcolm Jenkins done against two mop teams?
He had pretty good games. Think about it. He tackles very well. He tackled in open field.
He dropped the pick.
He dropped the pick, but he's a safety. He's not a wide receiver. Those drops don't count against him.
Man, that joint hit him in his hands.
It did, but he also had pass breakups as well.
Yeah. Well, we'll see this game against like AB and the boys.
Yeah, that's going to be a tough test, man. That's going to be a tough test because you got a rookie corner out there that's going to have.
Yeah, Mr. Mills.
Yeah, he's going to have to deal with.
Somebody.
And I see that Wheaton is
Marcus Wheaton. Yeah. So that just gives him another threat. So what you think, man?
Playoffs?
Oh, man, that killed me.
Playoffs? I just hope we can win a game.
No playoffs.
No playoffs?
Nah.
You don't think so?
Nah. Only way we make the playoffs is if we win the division. And I don't see that happening right now.
Right.
I mean, we gotta get through a lot of good teams in order to even think about the playoffs. I mean, the Steelers.
Playoffs? You kidding
playoffs.
Me?
Yeah, play it again, man. Because it's not
going to
happen.
It's not going to happen? Nah. Let me hit you with a stat. Teams that start 2-0, 60% go to the playoffs. That's not bad, man.
The Giants are 2-0 in our division. Only one team coming out of our division.
You said only one team? We haven't done that yet. We haven't looked at the league. I think we might say that for the next show when everybody kind of clears up. But out of our division. Well, actually, no.
It's
our,
only
going
to be one out.
Yeah, out of the NFC, who we see the wild cards, the division leaders, and so forth, you know, after a quarter of football.
Right. But, yeah, I just don't see it happening. I mean, they're going to still probably only win six games.
Right.
Yeah.
So, you know what that sound is. Let's get right into week three. And I had a good showing last week, man. I went 10-6 last week in my picks. 2-0 in the money bets. And I'm 3-1 on my lock picks. So, like I told people on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, when I see them, they know that I talk sports. Man, listen to me, please. I implore you. This is free money that I'm giving up with these lock bets. Now, I'm not going to get every game right. I am human. I do make mistakes right from time to time. But I'm started off 3-1. If you were to follow me every single way, you'd be holding on to some surplus money right now. So stick with me, man. I'm not just talking out my ass for no reason. Steve-O, we just going to keep it moving from your record. You didn't have a good week last week.
Yeah, my record was the record you had the week before. Right? So we're not going to do that because we flip-flop. Yeah, I like how you threw that in there.
Of course.
Yeah, exactly. So
we got to keep it 100, man.
I didn't have a good showing this week.
We got to keep it 100, bro. I mean, but you back this week, though.
Yeah,
easy.
Absolutely. A couple of these mock teams let me down. Washington stinks.
I can dig it. So, first game I got on the list here, big time game here, Denver and Cincy. We got no DeMarcus Ware, so a lot of focus is going to be on Miller. Their right tackle, their right starting tackle is out for Denver. I'm not even sure how you pronounce that quarterback's name.
Seisman.
Is it Seisman or Seaman? Pause.
What? Classic Moss moment.
What? You said it right with me. We got that on film, buddy.
Nah. I said Seisman.
No, but all right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We're gonna get the playback on that one.
Well, their quarterback, Denver's quarterback.
Yeah. So you know, it's his first road. Road test. I think since he lost last week, I forget the score of that game. I think it was
they lost to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I think it was was it a tight game? No, Pittsburgh opened the door on that one.
Yeah, they opened it up. At first it was tight. Neither one of them can really get into the end zone. But as the game went on, I think Pittsburgh, they started to pull away from them guys. And the score of that game was... Come on. 24-16 Pittsburgh.
Okay. So, with that being said, I actually think since he bounces back this week, it's a tough game to call. I mean, Denver could cover. I mean, since he can only win by 2 points, a field goal, or so forth. Since he is right now favored by 3, but I'm taking a home team. Lock me in, Cincy.
I'm going to go with Denver, man.
Okay.
I'm
not mad at you on that
Denver
pick.
Denver defense. And
they do have the best secondary,
right?
And
Pittsburgh has one of the worst. And to hold AJ Green to under 50 yards was, I mean, that was just really good. Their running game didn't get off.
That's not sleeping on Cincy's defense.
Right. But I also think that CJ Anderson will have a good game.
You think so?
Yeah, CJ Anderson's been balling lately. I mean, he's...
But Denver's quarterback, man, Mr. Seaman, he's a dink and dunk guy. No pun intended there.
Right.
So it's not like he's going to really stretch the field. So I mean, if Cincy gets stops, I can see Cincy.
See, Cincy gave up, what, over 100 yards last week in rushing. D'Angelo Williams had 94 on 32 attempts.
That's a lot. Yeah.
I mean, Sammy Colts, 2 receptions, 97 yards, which they did keep Antonio Brown intact. He only had 39 yards.
That doesn't happen, and it's the same with A.J. Green. I think. Right. I don't think A.J. Green. I don't think.
With these cornerbacks, Denver cornerbacks have been playing lights out last couple games. So.
Right. So you got Denver?
I got Denver.
Okay. So we go on next game. We got Oakland versus Tennessee. Oakland does have a leaky secondary that we've seen before. But nobody on that Tennessee team on that receiving corps scares me. Like, I don't...
Yeah, even Andre Johnson, I mean, he's old.
So. Yeah, so, I mean, the line is weird for some reason that... Hold on for a sec. We got a visitor.
in a ransom note.
I'm sorry. The guy from Sloman Shield to keep us protected is here. Well, tell Mr. Sloman Shield he's going to have to wait about 10, 15 minutes. We're in the middle of the podcast. Give him a beer. Tell him I'll be up there in 10, 15 minutes. I'm sorry for that, y'all.
He ain't coming in the house.
Hold on, buddy.
Yeah, come on, buddy. We're in the middle of a show, man. We're going to have to get a studio. This is getting ridiculous. So,
but back to Oakland.
Yeah, man. Back to Oakland.
I mean, Oakland has given up, they're ranked 30th in total defense. And Oakland pretty much had a good defense last year. I mean, I know they're missing a few players with Auden Smith, who was a good pass rusher on the other side of Khalil Mack. They're giving up the most total yards of offense with 470.
Right. Yeah, but who in Tennessee scares you, though? You think DeMarco Murray's going to run?
I'm sorry. They've gained the most total yards on offense. So they've been putting up 470 yards on offense, but they're 32nd ranked in total yards on defense, giving up 517.
It's because of that Saints game. They just blew the door off on them.
Yeah, and Atlanta.
Yeah, so that's 2 high-powered offenses, and right. Then you get Tennessee.
Passing yards, they rank 32nd, 404.
I like Oakland, man. What you got?
I like Oakland in the game.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not sure on Tennessee right now.
I don't believe in Tennessee. So, next game is... Who we got here?
Come on.
You already know what that sound means. Yes, sir. Zona and Buffalo. I'm going with Arizona. I mean, but it's funny, man. This could be a trap game.
Arizona, man. Lock it in.
Lock it in. Don't even talk about it.
Yeah. I just don't. I don't see Buffalo. They coming in with a new offensive coordinator.
No Sammy.
Their defense stinks.
No Sammy.
No Sammy Watkins. Larry Fitzgerald is playing like he's 28.
Lock it in.
Lock it in.
Okay, not enough. No more else to say. It could be a trap game, though. It would surprise me if Buffalo wins.
Lock it in.
But I'm putting my money, the mortgage, everything on Zona. So next game we got B. Moore in Jacksonville. And I think a lot of people, when I was seeing the trends, a lot of people are going, yeah, Jacksonville should win this game. You know, with Ivory, I think Chris Ivory is going to come back from his little, like, whatever medical issue that he had.
Right.
Should give a boost to the running game. But the Ravens have been an underrated defense. I have to look at who they played in the last 2 weeks. I didn't actually do that. But
they played the Browns.
Yeah.
Because they played the Browns last week, and they, you know, they covered. And the week before... week one, the Ravens played...
Was it Buffalo?
Yep, and they beat Buffalo 13-7.
So I think that defense is a little bit underrated, and Jacksonville can't run the ball, and I don't see them really... I don't see Bortles just coming out and just passing on them. Right, yeah, because, I mean, if you look at the Packers... You know, a lot of people are rating them on the Packers game because they played the Packers tough, but the Packers really hasn't gotten into an offensive swing yet. So, I think people are overrating Jacksonville.
Jacksonville just got blown out 28-0 last week.
Yeah. So, you would think they would bounce back, but I like Baltimore in this game.
Yeah, I like Baltimore.
Yeah, there we go, buddy.
Well, no, I'm sorry. They got blown out 38-14. They was down 28-0 at one point.
That's blown out, bro.
Yeah. 38-14 against San Diego.
All right. So, next game we got is Cleveland and Miami. What you got there, buddy? I'm not going to spend a long time on this.
Thank you, because I think I picked last week. Whoever Cleveland plays, pick them.
is that a lock, or are you just, nah?
Just pick Miami.
Just pick Miami?
Yeah, I like Miami.
I agree. Third starting quarterback for Cleveland. Nobody on offense, really, now.
Cleveland's hurt.
Yeah, they're picking people off the street, so... Right. I agree. I wouldn't surprise me if somehow, some way, Cleveland covers. I think it's -9.5 Miami right now.
Right.
So, and Miami hasn't really exploded offensively. You don't know what's going to happen. Even though Foster hasn't really shown much.
Foster's hurt.
Yeah.
He's not going to play.
I know, but I'm just saying he hasn't shown much, and Ajay hasn't shown much either. I actually like Drake? Alabama. Yeah. I actually like him as a little sleeper fantasy. He might get in the zone. He got in the zone last week.
Like Tannehill is a sleeper fantasy this week.
Good pick. I like Tannehill, too, as well. So, I'm with you here. Miami all the way. So, our next game is probably one of the games of the week with Mr. Josh Norman versus, Odell Beckham matchup. And they already...
Josh Norman is not going to follow him.
They came out and said that he was. You didn't hear that?
No, I didn't hear that. But yeah, we'll see. He don't want that problem, man.
Yeah, they came out and said Josh Norman. They said it like a day or two ago. They came out and said that Josh Norman will follow Odell Beckham.
That's the one he probably asked for.
He probably did.
He probably asked for that match.
Yeah, he probably did, and he's about to get toasted.
He ain't want none of Antonio Brown.
He's going to get toasted by Beckham. Like, it's going to be ugly. Like, people think the last game, he should have had 3 touchdowns on him.
He dropped the first one. That was on the first series. Yeah, he burned it by, like, 15 yards.
Unreal. I'm telling y'all right now, I'm playing Beckham in my fantasy because I feel like he's going to be up for this matchup, and he's going to show off.
And what's that, a 1 o'clock game?
I don't even know. Is that a 1 o'clock game or a 4 o'clock game?
It should have had. It can't be 4 o'clock.
No, because the Eagles. Yeah, because the Eagles. No, it's a 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock game on Fox. Yep. So that's definitely a game of the week game. So who you like, man? I know New York's favored by -4. Washington's offense is not looking good.
The Giants burned me in the last couple of weeks, man.
Yeah?
Well, the first week it was good. It was a pick'em, so they won by 1.
Okay.
Last week, they ain't covered, but I'm going to go with the Giants, man. I like the way they're playing collectively as a team.
I completely agree with you. I am going Giants, and this is another money pick, bro. I'm locking the Giants in, man. I really like the Giants here. I think that the Giants D is still surging.
Right.
They're playing well. Washington on offense, starting with Cousins, just doesn't look in sync.
And DeJuan is hurt, too.
Yeah, D-Jack is hurt somewhat a little bit. I don't know. I think he still plays. But
yeah, he got
he always kills the Giants, doesn't he?
He has an ankle and a knee injury. So, I mean, I don't know how much that factors in on
But he always kills the Giants, though. That's all.
But he usually kills Dallas.
I think he kills New York, too, though, bro. Yeah. He kills New York a lot, too.
But
I like the Giants. Yeah, I like the Giants, and it's a must. It is a must win for Washington. But
that's the only scary part because it's a must win. They can't go down 0-3 in the division.
No, they can't. Yeah. They can't. So, yeah.
I mean,
I hear you, bro. I hear you. But I love New York. I think ODB shows up, and they just have too much on offense. Cruz is starting to come back.
Well, 0-2 in the division. I'm sorry.
And Shepard is surgeon as well.
Yeah.
As another as another option in that offense. So next game we got here is Detroit versus Green Bay. I kind of like the over in this game. Detroit really has no running game. Neither does Green Bay. The line is kind of high. I think it's at like 50. Detroit always has been playing Green Bay tough the last year, last two games.
Right.
But there's no Ezekiel Nish, and that's how you say his name.
Okay. The DM.
Yeah, the DM from Detroit.
It's 47.
Is it 47? Yeah. I'm sorry. So 47. I like Rodgers at home, but if I'm betting money on this one, you know, it's the over. I'm taking the over on that one.
That's interesting. I mean, because Detroit has been playing pretty good. I mean, Matthew Stafford, their offense is fifth in total yards with 411 yards a game.
He's going to have to throw all day. He's gonna throw 45 to 40 times.
Right. Seventh in passing offense with 285 passing yards
a game. Mm-hmm.
Rushing is not bad, though. They're ninth in rushing.
Yeah, but they lost Abdullah.
Yeah, but Theo Riddick is still.
Yeah, but they don't want him to run the ball. They want Theo Riddick to be what he is.
Right, right.
And
like,
I think
like it's Shane Vereen almost.
Right, and I think the rookie's name is, I want to say his name is Dwayne Washington. I know his last name is Washington, but I forget his first name.
Okay.
And you know, you don't know what you're going to get. Now Clay Matthews is out this game,
right.
which is kind of big. But that just tells me that Green Bay is not going to get home, you know, in the pass rush. So I just see passing all day. I just see Rodgers and Stafford going at it all day, and who can outlast
him. Let me tell you this. If you can buy Green Bay down a few points.
A teaser?
Yeah, if you can tease them.
I have that on a teaser. I have Green Bay minus one.
Green Bay.
Just the win, right?
I like Green Bay.
Just the win, yeah.
So, if you can buy Green Bay down to about 4 points.
I got him at minus one.
Okay. Yeah.
Just to win the game.
Yeah, I like that. I mean, straight up 7 points. Green Bay's been, had some tough games, so I'm not quite sure on that.
So I see, real quick, I see somebody else join the Facebook Live. I see you, BP. Thanks for the shout-out, bro. Next game we got is Minnesota and Carolina. So we got no AP, and a lot of people are kind of not back and forth. But I'm one of those believers that Minnesota's offense might actually be better without AP. Now, before you start getting on your rant, North Turner likes to pass to his running backs. That wasn't...
What's in this cup, Nate?
It's gone, bro. It's gone. But, I mean, I'm just telling you right now. Now, I was on the last night session, remember, I had a cup of my two-step last night, and I actually did well, so... This little bit of yak might be good for me. The little
that
pimp
might
juice.
Have been too much in this one for you to say that they're better without Adrian Peterson. Now I will say Adrian Peterson hasn't had a breakout game this year yet.
He hasn't had a game period. He's been trash.
Just having a threat in the presence of Adrian Peterson in your backfield makes the defense think differently.
Right.
So you have to account for him on every aspect. Because it's Adrian Peterson, and you know that any time he can break a long touchdown.
Right.
So it forces you to play...
The run.
Right.
And only the run.
More people in the box.
I think it simplifies their offense with him.
Without Adrian Peterson in the backfield, teams don't have to stack the box. Now they can focus more on Stephon Diggs and...
And he had a big game last game. I don't think he has a big game like that this game. And
he's not going to have a big game because Carolina, I'm not going to say he's not going to have a big game because he still might have a big game because he's that kind of player. But
are we over at past two games? Are we just saying that now? I mean, he exploded last game for 182 yards and a touchdown.
He was consistent last year as well as a rookie.
He had
pretty good numbers as a rookie last year. But... With Adrian Peterson out of the game, it makes the defense play totally different. Now they're going to focus on Sam Bradford and his passing because I'm not scared of their running backs. Who was it? McKinnon and Asiata?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, I'm not scared of neither one of them. So
shout out my homie Ross. I see you, money. Good luck on the shout out, bro. And BP said that Bradford is going to get hurt before before we even played him. So he thinks he's going to get hurt by the time they come to Philly, which is might be the case. And I would love, I don't want to wish anything bad. He took
a ton of hits last game.
But I would love for him to get hurt, because you know what that means. That means that draft pick is going to go through the roof with Sean Hill and no AP running that offense.
Well, the draft pick, yeah, definitely, yeah.
We could end up getting a top 10 pick, which is insane. That'd be crazy. And yo, MPP, MoneyPot podcast, got to be in the building for the Philadelphia draft. So, who do you like in that game? You didn't really say.
I like Carolina.
I like Carolina, too. I think Cam doesn't really do well against good defenses, and let's not discredit Minnesota's defense. They are a good defense. But Sam doesn't really do that great against, you know, good defense as well. And as many years as he's been in the league, he's not even really battle tested against really good defenses because he's always hurt. So he hasn't seen them enough,
right?
You know, to really kind of gauge him. The spread is high. I think the spread is like 7.5 Carolina.
Because I guess they're looking at it like, okay, Minnesota without Adrian Peterson is almost similar to San Fran, and they beat San Fran by what? 19, I believe.
So they got more talent than San Fran.
They have more talent, but...
And Khalil... And what's his name? Not Khalil Mack.
Their defense is good, too.
No, their left tackle. Minnesota's left tackle's out. Matt Khalil, I think, is out.
And Sam Bradford took a ton of hits last week.
So right.
I like Carolina.
Yeah, I wouldn't surprise me if Minnesota covers in this game, but I like Carolina. If I'm betting it, I'm taking Carolina with a touchdown. So, next game is 49ers and Seattle. Now, I honestly think this game right here is a trap game because I think everybody's going to be betting the Niners. They don't see anything from Seattle. Seattle's hurt. Right. Thomas Rawls isn't playing. Their offense looks like nothing. Their defense is still elite. But, you know, they score one offensive touchdown so far in two games?
Yeah, in the first game in Miami.
I think Seattle gets back to running the ball. I think they get back in sync.
But see, they got to count on Christian Michael to run the ball.
Yeah, I know. And that's tough. That's a tough call because you don't know what he's going to do. As actually, it's funny. My man BP had asked me in the Money Pop podcast forum on Facebook, would I go Michaels or who was the other guy? Michaels. It was a receiver that just played on Thursday. Fuller from Houston. And I told him Fuller because I felt like Fuller, you know, he had two strong games.
Definitely.
And he was actually, you know, Patriots defense is actually better than I actually thought it was.
Mm-hmm.
But if you watch that game, Osweiler was off, man. I mean, and it was you have to credit Patriots for playing good ball, but Osweiler was off. But Fuller got the targets. I think he had like 7 to 9 targets in that game. He only came away with
a drop.
He had a drop, but he did get the targets. And the 49ers have an underrated run defense, I think. And you know, Christian Michaels is going to get the carry, especially with Rawls being labeled as being out for the game. But I think Russell Wilson shows up.
San Fran, they've given up the average 120 yards on defense. So they've given up 120 rushing yards per game so far.
I like Russell Wilson in this game, man. Don't sleep on Russell Wilson in, you know, fantasy or any type of draft games.
10-point spread.
That's 9.5. It dropped a little bit.
Seattle minus 10. So they got a 1 by 11. That's asking a lot because they barely scored.
Man, they in Seattle, man. I love Seattle in this game. I think Seattle wins straight up. I'm not going to lock them in, but it wouldn't be in my money bet. But if, you know, if I'm putting it on a parlay or something like that, right, or even a teaser to tease them down, I'm taking Seattle in this game.
Yeah, if you can tease them down, man. I like San Fran to cover in this
one. Okay.
With the 10, I like San Fran to cover.
And that's just because a lot of people, I think, are seeing – you know, the way Seattle's playing. But I think Seattle wakes up in this game. It's a perfect game for them to wake up against a bum squad.
I just look at it like San Fran put up 27 points against Carolina.
Right.
And their defense not slouch.
Right.
Yeah, so, I like San Fran to cover.
So BP just asked me for, it looks like all tight ends, Pitta, Barnage, or Tame. I'm not sure who Tame is.
Tammy.
Oh, Tammy. Where's Tammy?
He's in Atlanta.
He's in Atlanta?
Yeah. T-A-M-M-E?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. No, well, he spelled him T-A-M-M. That's what messed me up. Yes, Tim A. Is it A-M-M-E?
T-A-M-M-E.
Yeah, you missed the E there, buddy. You messed me up live. So, I got to go.
Who was the three again?
Barnage.
Tammy.
And Pita from Baltimore. Well, what you think there, buddy? Who's Baltimore playing again?
Baltimore is playing...
Jacksonville. And then...
I had to go with Barnage.
You going with Barnage?
He's the only option.
I don't like Barnage. You know who I like in that game? I like Duke Johnson in that game. I like a lot of dump balls. It's a rookie quarterback. Be safe.
Oh, yeah, it is a rookie quarterback.
Yeah, it's a third rookie quarterback.
But most quarterbacks, you think about it, they enjoy the tight end.
They do like the tight end.
That's their safety.
But I think that's the safety is really just a little swing screen. Because it's usually open for 5 yards, and you hope your guy makes somebody miss, you know, and can make a play. You know, tight ends do still have to make, you know, run some type of routes. Right. So, you know, Pitta, he had a pretty strong game last game. I think he had over 100 yards, right? He had like 8-something catches.
Did he?
I think.
And that's against Cleveland.
Yeah, I think he had a pretty good game, and then
he had 102 yards.
Yeah, he had a pretty good game. So is he burnt out? Does he have another strong showing?
I actually might have to like.
BP. Let us get back to that one. Let us kind of.
Jacob Tammy had a really good game too.
Yeah. What he had?
5 receptions, 75 yards, and a touchdown.
And that Atlanta-New Orleans game might be high scoring. And it's on Monday. So, you know, if you think about that as your fantasy, you know, you look at who you're facing. And if they have anybody go on Monday, you might want to counteract that with another player go on Monday, too. Right. That's a good strategy as well.
Barnage only had 37 yards last week.
I'm taking Barnage out of it. I wouldn't go Barnage.
I wouldn't go Barnage.
It's either the two. And then I think out of the two, I'm leaning towards – Tammy, just because that matchup might be it's potential to be high scoring.
Yeah.
So, you know, and Julio's ailing. You know, he's not 100% healthy, but when is Julio 100% healthy? So let's go to the next game, and we'll get to that game soon enough. We got L.A. and Tampa, the Rams and Tampa Bay.
I'm going Tampa Bay.
Yeah, man, I'm going Tampa Bay. I'm almost locked this one in, too. I mean, L.A., they just have Gurley. Like, there's nothing in the Rams' offense.
A lot of people may look like, well, they played Seattle tough last week and beat them, but they always play Seattle.
Yeah, they play Seattle tough. I actually think Tampa Bay wins easily here.
Yeah.
Okay. So, next game we got, 4 o'clock game. Should be game of the week. Oh, killing it. There we go. Sorry about that sound. Not working there. But Pittsburgh, that is no longer Pittsburgh, and our own Philadelphia Eagles. So we all know Pittsburgh, you know, what is Wentz going to do against Pittsburgh? It's really the question. This is going to be the first question. This is the first time he's going to be against good, talented players, good defense.
And they run a traditional 3-4.
So yeah, but they're not Pittsburgh anymore, like I said before. It's going to be a lot of underneath stuff open.
You got to figure out where that fourth rusher coming from, and that's going to be something that he needs to try to pick up and use his hard counts to his advantage. But, I mean, that traditional 3-4
right.
confuses a lot of quarterbacks. It confuses, you know, veterans because you have no idea where that extra rusher coming from. You know the 3-down lineman. Sometimes one might not come, but...
Doesn't the Browns have a 3-4 even though they stink?
I think they got a hybrid, though.
Okay.
I think they went back over to like a 4.
I'm just saying that because it's not, it's not like anything he hasn't seen. Like, he's seen the front.
No, it is something he never seen because neither.
But it's not Blitzburg. It's not the same Pittsburgh with Dick LeBeau.
Their linebackers are really, really good. So you.
Yeah, they are.
They got really good linebackers with Simmons, Shazier. You can even put in Harrison is still out there.
And what's his name? Jones? Is his last name Jones?
Yeah. I think he played in.
He's a linebacker. Yeah, he played in Georgia. I forget his name. But he's a good player though.
So it's a lot of guessing that Carson Wentz is going to have to do, like guessing who's coming or try to watch the film. They say he's really good at watching film, so hopefully that works. But this is going to be the test for him, and I honestly think that Pittsburgh covers the spread.
Good call. I'm not mad at that call. I went a little bit different. I actually think that it's going to be a shootout. And shout out to my homie E, who just gave me a shout out. Man, I see you, bro. I think that the D line has to play their best game. They got to move Big Ben off his spots. I actually think it's going to be a shootout. I think Pittsburgh scores at least 24 points in this game. And, if you look at the Eagles' offense, there has been some drop touchdowns, even though, Wentz hasn't, thrown, for 2 or 3 touchdowns.
Right.
It wouldn't surprise me if he throws for 2 or 3 touchdowns and maybe a pick in this game. I like him, actually, in DraftKings because he's cheap. I like AB in DraftKings. So, you already see.
Jordan Matthews might not be a bad pickup, neither, because they got their rookie safety coming down covering the slot.
Slot, okay.
Yeah, so. I mean, watch Jordan Matthews in this game, too, if you guys can get him for cheap. Are you worrying about if you can just start him or somebody else?
Good call. But,
I mean, they got their rookie, like I said, a rookie safety coming down to cover the slot. And Jordan Matthews has had really good games. I mean, with that drop last week, he would have been over 100 yards in the touchdown, but...
He has had good games, and Aguilar's turning into their quote-unquote, deep threat. I think they take a shot with Aguilar as well. Like I said, I think this game's going to be a shootout, but the way I'm betting it, I'm betting over. I think, they're going to score points, and, key AB for DraftKings. So you see my stack. I'm going to give y'all a little snippet of that. My stack in all DraftKings is going to be Odell Beckham and AB, man. So I'm going with that stack, and then I'm playing off that. So cue me in for the over. If I could tease that down, I think we can tease it down. It's like 40 points, 40 and a half. So I'm definitely doing that. Next game, we have the Jets, the J-E-T-S, Jets, and those Kansas City Chiefs. Yo, the Jets are good, man.
No, the Jets
even with Marshall out, like I still think the Jets are good. That defense is still dangerous.
Right.
I like, even though Revis is beginning slack, I like Revis versus Macklin if that's the matchup. I like Revis in that matchup.
Revis is good for one toast the game, man.
But I don't think Macklin's going to toast him, though.
I mean, listen, he's good for one.
We'll see. And I like that D-line against the Chiefs O-line. Jamal Charles is out. He's not playing.
Sound like you're going Jets.
Yeah, I'm going Jets, buddy. With the points, man. That's +3. I like that play there, buddy.
And he's playing in Arrowhead, right?
Yeah, Arrowhead is definitely a tough place to play, but I just don't see Alex Smith doing enough on that defense.
I hate Alex Smith.
I
know. I can tell.
He's in the par of Teddy Bridgewater, my two greatest players I just don't like. It's like he's just nothing. He's just terrible.
Yeah, I could tell by the way you've been talking about him recently.
Look at that. Shout out Mikey Wells for joining, man.
Mike Wells.
What's up, buddy?
That's a hard one, man. I actually...
You like the Chiefs.
I like the Chiefs.
I felt you
I just think
on the Chiefs.
The only thing, though, the Chiefs is going to have a tough time rushing the ball.
Exactly. And that means Alex Smith has got to beat him, and I just don't see that.
They're going to have a tough time rushing the ball against New York.
So what you got? Who you got? Coin flip.
This is a coin flip, man. I'm going to go with the Chiefs, man, because I like my man Andy.
Okay. You got a dual head coin for your coin flip.
It's all black.
Yes, sir. Always bet on black. Better believe it. So it's funny how you say it's a coin flip, because I think the next one for me is a coin flip. We got Luck versus Rivers, the Chargers versus the Colts. It could easily be a San Diego win, or easily a Colts win. Right. You know, Moncrief does hurt the Colts. Moncrief is out.
I don't think so. Not too much.
Well, because
Dorsett.
It's a Dorsett. Dorsett, yeah.
Is good. Yeah.
Yeah, to me, Dorsett is a speed guy. He's not like an intermediate guy like Moncrief is. They give him that order intermediate
he
routes.
He can be. You give him the same routes.
We'll see. And then but San Diego's deep secondary is actually good. I forget his name. Is it Jarrett back there? What's his? It's a corner guy who's actually coming into his own. Okay. I know their secondary is pretty legit. You know, I really think it comes down who's going to will, you know,
their
this
team the most.
Yeah, there's this team to win.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's a ton of injuries. Does that catch up finally with San Diego?
Right.
I like Melvin Gordon in fantasy because the Colts' defense is still trash.
I like Travis Benjamin again this week. Man.
Yeah, he had a good game last game.
And I called him last week.
He did.
I like him, man. I like Rivers in this game as well. He was one of the guys that I looked at to see that.
Right,
I
mean, that's a good pick too.
If you can get both of them.
That's a good DraftKings pick for Rivers if he's not high.
Yeah, and Benjamin's not going to be high, so.
Yeah, true. I like that stat. Yeah. I'm going Colts. I just don't see Luck.
I'm going Colts too.
I don't see Luck going 0-3.
Yeah, I don't see it happening.
I'm scared of that pick, but I'm going Colts.
I'm gonna go Colts too.
Bro. All right, good call there, Steve-O. So next one we got is them Bad News Bears, and here come the Cowboys. I hate to say it, but I think here comes the Cowboys. I think Elliott might finally have his breakout game.
I hope so, because I got
he got him in fantasy. I think he gets in the zone at least twice. I don't know how many yards or rushing yards or you know receiving yards he might get, but I think he might get in the end zone twice. The Bears are terrible.
Yeah, and this the crazy thing about it, man. This could be a game that could be a trap game as well.
It could be. Hoyer could surprise people.
Right, but I don't know, man. The Bears, they're struggling on defense. Even they just lost Danny Trevathan. He got a thumb injury.
Right, right.
So.
Didn't he go on like IR? Like, was it that bad?
I don't know, but. Yeah. I'm going to go with Dallas as much as I hate them.
Yeah, I heard. They're just a more talented team. Yeah. And then and the Bears lost one in the Eagles game. I forget his name. I think his name was Johnson, but they lost a big one of the defensive linemen.
Okay.
91. I forget his last name, but I know he went out and he's not playing this game. And that offensive line is already stout on Dallas. So
right.
I like the Cowboys, even though it's a scary -7. I do like the Cowboys. So for the Monday night game, we got Atlanta and the Saints. People are going to be all over the over in this game just because of the offensive presence, and the Saints really don't have a defense. But I think they showed me last week that they can play defense. You know,
they definitely did. Yeah. The Giants was a good offense.
Exactly. So
and they didn't score on the Giants didn't score on offense. They scored a defensive touchdown.
Right, right. And it's the 10-year anniversary of Katrina.
Right.
Going to be a lot of emotion and just that building is going to be rocking. So I'm going with Breeze at home, man. I like the Saints in that game.
I like the Saints, and I also like Breeze as a must start in your fantasy.
Yeah, I got him in Cooks, so we're going to have to show out this game. So there was a couple fantasy nuggets in there on the way. We're not going to do a whole big fantasy at the end, but my only fantasy stat, like I said before, is I'm definitely going Brown, A.B., and Odell Beckham as my two receivers. Now, that's going to kill a lot of your money. And right, your DraftKings, because right. I think that both of those guys are like over $9,000. So you have to be really smart in how you pick next on your quarterback, your tight ends, and your defenses of, you know, prowess. And another key defense for fantasy that we didn't even talk about, not even a sleeper, is definitely Miami with the Browns coming into town. Mm-hmm. So
they're going to push them up. Some,
yeah, so. Key Miami on DraftKings, key AB. Definitely listen to the homie Steve-O because he's been right. You know, I think this might be if you get these two right 3 weeks in a row, where you keyed definitely a good fantasy pick in Rivers and Travis Benjamin. I think you said a couple other players.
I like Tannehill, Rivers, Breeze as well. Larry Fitzgerald, Travis Benjamin, Duke Johnson, and C.J. Anderson.
I like Duke. Yeah. I like Duke Johnson this week.
And I mean, not Duke Johnson. I'm sorry. I take that back. David Johnson. And C.J. Anderson.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually like Duke Johnson because I just think he's going to get a lot of catches out the backfield in PPR. And I definitely like, what's that guy's name? Melvin Gordon to keep his run going on. So that concludes today's Money Pop podcast. So definitely continue to listen. I appreciate everybody who does listen. And hopefully you've been entertained in your participation on Facebook. But you know what? I got to go upstairs and check on the fam. So we out of here, boy.
Jeez.
You get it. You know what you're gonna tell me.